Good morning, and welcome to Grace Church this morning. My name is Matt Weaverink, and I'm an elder here at Grace, and it's my privilege to lead you in worship this morning. I'm glad you're here, whether it's in this building, or watching at home, or maybe you're at the trailer at Lakewood. I know there's quite a few of you out there this weekend. Welcome you in this morning to join us for worship. This morning, we're going to do something a little different. We're going to be streaming our message as a video sermon from Forest City Community Church in London. And that's a message from Pastor Rob Hogendorn there and from a couple weeks ago. It's part of a series they're doing on the Ten Commandments, but I think you'll find out it holds up on its own as well. And today, I think somewhat fittingly, as a long weekend, it's all about rest. We've all come here with different burdens and different stressors, and maybe you've been out in the field working all week, putting in some long hours. So I invite you all to come to this place this morning and just rest in God's grace and in his presence. Jesus, who died for us, invites us here saying, "Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest." As we meet God in this place this morning, we're reminded that he was here before us and that his spirit is here now calling us to worship him. So I'll ask you to rise for God's greeting. Congregation, our awesome, loving God greets us this morning with these words from 2 Corinthians 3, verse 14. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. So how do we respond to that? The God who holds the whole world, the whole universe in his hands, invites us into his presence. How do we respond to that? In the book of Revelation, we read about the four living creatures who are in God's presence, and they are just worshiping without stopping. Day and night, they're singing, "Holy, holy, holy, Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come." So let's open our service this morning with that as well. Let's worship our great and holy God. seated. We've come to the point this morning where we confess our sins, the ways we've come up short of what God requires of us. We start by glorifying God, by recognizing his awesomeness, his holiness, his glory. And when we do that and we dig deeper into God's word, we see the way that we should respond is not the way that we do. It doesn't take long for us to recognize that we fall short. The sermon we've selected for today talks about one of the Ten Commandments, and I tell you, it doesn't take long to go through those commandments to start to realize how much we fall short. As I was thinking about that over the past week, I got to thinking, does anybody else feel like the prodigal son over and over again on a daily basis? So I've got a picture I'd like to show on the screen, and it's a painting. It's from Rembrandt. It's called The Return of the Prodigal Son. Just to give you something to reflect on for a moment. And you can see that prodigal son comes back to the father, and he's just burying his head in his father's chest. His father's embracing him, even holding him up. One of the things that stands out to me about this story in Luke 15 is how the father runs out to meet the son. He's got this whole rehearsed message, this speech he wants to give to his father about how sorry he is, about taking his inheritance, basically wishing that his father was dead. Before he can even spit that speech out, his father just embraces him. You know, the father didn't have to run out to meet him, but he was standing there watching and waiting for him to come back. And to put grace on top of grace, he throws a huge party for his son to celebrate that he has come back. What an incredible image that is of God's grace for all of us. God gives us this incredible gift, an eternal inheritance. He calls us his sons and daughters through Jesus, and he gives us new life, and what do we do with it? We take this incredible gift and this knowledge of God's plan for us and his promise to sustain us, and we say thanks, but no thanks, God. We skip out on praying or reading the Bible or listening to some biblical teaching because we need our downtime. Or we need a vacation or a nice round of golf. You know, not that there's anything wrong with those things, but as long as we don't put them first. We look for happiness and satisfaction, joy and rest in all the wrong places. And when all that still isn't enough, maybe then we finally come back to God, feeling guilty and empty from trying to buy into what the world is trying to sell us. We come back hoping for just a little bit of joy we had when we were truly following him and worshiping him. And how does God respond? This is the best part. When we give ourselves to God, when we run to the Father, truly sorry for what we've done, we find we can't even make it to him before he comes out to meet us with his arms open wide. And if you haven't experienced that kind of grace yet, if you've been carrying a burden of guilt far too long in your heart, God's inviting us all this morning with open arms. Lay down your burdens at the cross, empty your heart before him, and find rest in him. Let's pray. Father God, as we come before you this morning with our heads bowed, we confess that we've come up short of what you call us to be and what you call us to do. We've taken your gift of grace, and we've turned it away. We've taken your gift of love, we said thanks, but no thanks. We've put ourselves first instead of giving you all the glory and all the praise that you were due. And yet, when we run back to you, before we can even say a word, you make the first move. You meet us on the road with open arms. Forgive us, Lord, for the times we've sinned against you and against each other. And help us, Father, to extend that same forgiveness and grace to those around us. Amen. I invite you to stand now as we sing about that grace together.
To you.
this time we'll have the kids come up to the front for Sunday school this morning. Hey guys. So I don't know how many of you guys were here last time I was doing the children's message, but I brought this suitcase along and nobody wanted to open it. So does anybody want to open it this time? I think you actually volunteered last time. So here you go. Go. You can open it. Here. Come on down here. Come on down here and open it up. It's right here. Right here. Right here. Just pull that zipper all the way. Open it up. All right. Let's see what's in here. Oh, that's weird. What is this? Anybody tell me what this is? What is it? Yeah.
A pillow.
A pillow, yeah. And you can tell it's mine because there's a little drool spot on in there from when I take a nap in the afternoon. And, oh, I got this down here too. Look at that. Yeah, a little bunny, eh? A little stuffy. That's nice. Some, I know some of you guys probably have stuffies and things too to keep you, just make you feel safe and comfortable, right? So this morning, we're going to be talking about rest. And you know what? One of the Ten Commandments is God said that we have to keep the Sabbath day holy, and we're supposed to rest on one day a week. So it's really important that we rest. And God gives us these rules, not just to give us rules, not just because he wants us to do things, but God gives us these rules because that's the best way that we can serve him, and that's the best way we can live as well. So in the Bible, Jesus says that we can come to him for true rest as well. So if we're looking for rest, that's a good way. And you know what else I heard the other day? Was that sometimes taking a nap can be a spiritual exercise. So I bet you a bunch of you guys are actually doing some spiritual disciplines in the afternoon, which is really good. Because God calls us to rest, and it's an important thing for our minds and our hearts to be refreshed. So next time you have to take a nap or your parents tell you to go to bed, just remember that God calls us all to rest, and that's the way that we can be the best version of ourselves as well, and the best way that we can serve him. All right? So we're going to pray, and then you guys are going to go downstairs. Heavenly Father, thank you for, these children here. Thank you that they could be present and just worshiping with us. And thank you for Sunday school that they have downstairs. Pray that you would be with their teachers and that they would learn a lot more about you and about your love and what you call us to be and what you call us to do. Thank you for laying out very clearly in your word that we need rest, because sometimes we forget about that, but it's important for us to go back to that, God, and we thank you for opportunities to rest as well, and we thank you for sending Jesus, most of all, who tells us that we can come to him when we are weary and heavy laden and just burdened, and we can find true rest in him. I pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. You guys go downstairs.
Good morning. Our offerings this morning are for congregational ministries as well as World Renew. World Renew embraces a family-centered approach to ending global poverty with food security, peace and justice, economic livelihood, and health. There are a few ways to give your offering. Of course, you can drop it off with the deacons in the lobby or email transfer or bring it to the church during the week. Also received a prayer request from Dina Dreisa. Dina's brother, Adrian Van Rooyen of Strathroy, fell last Sunday and fractured his arm in three places, as well as his hip. At this time, his recovery is hampered by complications from diabetes, and so we'll include Adrian in our prayer. We're also going to pray for Nathan Duma, the son of George and Hilda, who needs treatment on his aorta and is waiting for that. Shall we pray? God, our Father, creator of all, bless us this Sunday morning as we come to worship you. We gather to honor and give glory to you. We praise you in our prayer and in our songs and in our worship. We are grateful for the warming temperatures, the many signs of spring that show us that you are in control. The seasons change and you remain steadfast. We praise you, O Lord, and we give you thanks. We thank you for the privilege to worship together. Bless those who are worshiping with us online. Help each of us feel your presence as we come together as your church family. Give comfort to those who deal with illness or other restrictions, and bless those of our members who are confined to their homes. Let them feel the peace that only you can give. Be with Nathan Duma, Lord. We pray that he's able to get the treatment he needs very soon. We pray for healing, and we pray for your grace. Bless also Elko Maniblik as he prepares for surgery this week. We pray that the surgery will be successful. Give him and Tina peace and patience in the coming weeks, and let them feel your presence in their lives, calming any anxious moments and easing anxious thoughts. Lord, also bless Dean Dreis's brother, Adrian. Give him healing and give him patience and strength during this time. Help him seek comfort in you. We also ask for your blessings on Susie Postma with her health concerns. She needs your guiding care. Give strength, too, to her family who is supporting her and loves her dearly. We commend to you all the needs within our church, Lord, and our community. We don't know them all, but you do, and we put them in your hands. We rejoice with several of our church community who will be marking birthdays this week. We celebrate with Silas, Edith, Charlie, and Teresa. We pray for joyous time with their loved ones as they mark these milestones. A number of church programs have wrapped up or will be wrapping up soon, and we're thankful for our leaders and for all the participants. Thank you for all the committee members and program leaders who give of their time in various areas to run the church. We ask that you bless the bike rodeo that is coming up in a couple of weeks. Thank you for the planners, and we pray for a good event that we are able to make a positive impact to our community near the church. We pray for a blessing on our offerings as well, Lord. We pray that the money collected will be used effectively to further your kingdom. Thank you for World Renew. Bless their work and the workers and the communities that they serve. As we now get ready to hear your word, we ask that you give us open hearts to receive the message. Bless the reading of Scripture and bless Matt as he brings this message to us. Thank you for his willingness and ability to come here this morning and lead us in our worship. And all these things we pray in your name. Amen.
All right, so I will not be doing the sermon, but I will be introducing it. As we mentioned earlier in the service, this morning's message is from Pastor Rob Hogendorn at Forest City Community Church in London. As part of a series on the Ten Commandments there, we're jumping into the middle of it a bit, but I think it's pretty familiar, so I'm not too worried about that. And this week, it's all about rest. Now, if you are interested in seeing more of the sermon series that they're doing there, just in case you're curious or you have some time you want to look at that, they are on YouTube, similar to our church, at Forest City Community Church. So I'll let the sermon roll now.
Hey, so this past week, I was reading about a cardiologist by the name of Meyer Friedman, and you may or may not have heard of this man, but among other things, he's kind of famous because he and another guy are the ones who developed the whole notion of the type A personality. You know, the kind of driven, high energy, gotta get it done, even a bit anxious, easily irritated, fast-paced lifestyle, the type A personality. So just for curiosity, how many of you would say in the room you sort of fit under that category? How many type A's in the room? Okay. How many of you are sitting beside somebody who didn't put their hand up, but you personally know they actually are a type A? Yeah, exactly. Thank you for that. Just so we have full honesty in the room today. It's very good, very good. You know, Meyer was actually a cardiologist, And his personality profiling emerged from the people that came to his practice. Very interesting. And one of the ways it was confirmed is so fascinating to me. There was an upholsterer who was working in Friedman's office, and he said, "Have you ever noticed the pattern of wear on the chairs? That is, there's something unusual about it on the chairs in your office." And Friedman said, "No, I didn't really notice it at all." And the upholsterer said, "Well, you know that you would expect on a chair that the fabric would be worn all the way around the surface of the chair, but in your office, it's not that way. In your office, it gets worn out first on the edge of the chair, the front edge." In other words, there's something about people who are coming to see a heart specialist, who have heart conditions, that where they're sitting on the edge of their seats with these thoughts running through their minds, and these thoughts are, "I'm anxious, I'm afraid, I'm upset, I don't have time for this, I don't want to be here." They were actually wearing out the chairs in Meyer Friedman's office on the edge of their seats. That's one of the ways this whole notion of the type A personality was confirmed, because we live in a society where people go through life on the edge of their seats. And it's not just type A personalities, but so many of us. I was reading a newspaper article, these quirky stories out of a Seattle, Washington newspaper that was reporting on a recent adventure of a basset hound named Tattoo. If you know basset hounds, they are cute little dogs with stubbly little legs. And this was an article about this basset hound named Tattoo. Tattoo didn't intend to go for an evening run, but when his owner shut the dog's leash in the car door and took off for a drive, Tattoo was still outside the vehicle but had no choice but to run. And a motorcycle officer named Terry Filbert noticed the passing vehicle with something dragging behind it, and it was, as Filbert said, the basset hound picking up his feet and putting them down as fast as he could. And he chased the car to a stop, and Tattoo was rescued, but not before the dog had reached speeds of 20 to 25 miles an hour, rolling over multiple times. Now, dog's all right, no animal was hurt in this illustration. But a lot of us, if we're honest, we spend most of our lives like this little basset hound. Our days are marked by picking up our feet and putting them down as fast as we can. We are in a series this spring called The Big Ten, and we've been putting the spotlight on the most famous set of laws that have ever been communicated. They've inspired the moral codes of entire civilizations for over 3,500 years. And we're talking about the Ten Commandments. Those 10 big things that God communicated with his Old Testament people as they were leaving 400 years of slavery in Egypt, and they were just about to enter into the Promised Land. And we've been probing and understanding more about the original context of these iconic words, but even more, we've been looking at their enduring relevance and benefit for each of our lives all these years later. And after the very first few commandments that have to do with, you know, keeping God first in your life and watching out for idols and counterfeit gods and keeping God central and respecting his name, God communicates the number 4 of the Big Ten. And it's the remember to rest commandment. So let me read it for you, and then we'll talk about this. This is what the Bible says. It says, "Remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. And on it you shall not do any work, neither you nor your son or daughter, nor your servant or your animals, nor the guest in your home. For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, the sea and all that is in them, but he rested on the seventh day. And therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy." So this morning I want to do 2 things. I want to start by taking some time to think about this commandment and understand its relevance for our lives today. And then I want to end with some practical handles, some practical practices for putting this into practice in our lives. And one of the first things you notice when you read the fourth commandment is it speaks very clearly to the contrasting realities of work and rest. Work and rest. You know, sometimes we look at the Bible verses, sometimes we look at Bible passages, And we wonder and think, wow, that actually doesn't connect with our lives today. Maybe way back then it did, but it's not all that relevant today. But not this passage, not a passage like this. These words maybe have never been more needed than in the world that you and I are in right now, right today. And I want you to think about where and when we are living right now in Canada, 2023. I mean, the country we live in is a prosperous, rich land. And despite our national debt and other domestic problems, Canada is among the most prosperous countries in the world. And there's several reasons and factors behind this. Peaceful heritage, you know, borders that aren't under threat, natural resources. But one of the key reasons that perhaps stands out above all the others is, by and large, Canadians work hard. Okay, not all of them do. I'll be true about that. But most do. What's known as the Protestant work ethic, that's been part of the very fiber of the country's pioneers, is still alive and well in 2023 Canada. And the benefits of that work ethic are obvious. I mean, we have one of the highest standards of living, and despite a lot of problems, we have a pretty good healthcare system. We have, on the whole, a very good educational system. We have people who, the greatest majority by far, would much rather work and support themselves than depend on welfare or other assistance. Canada is an attractive place for international companies to set up manufacturing plants because Canadians are known as being well-trained, conscientious, and hardworking. But what I'd like you to see this morning is that alongside of that work ethic that has resulted in so many benefits in our lives, there is a destructive downside that impoverishes people's lives all the time. And it's what I call the work-dominated approach to life. The work-dominated approach. Most of us have been raised and enculturated in a setting of high-level achievement, of a neurotic compulsion to perform and produce and accomplish more and more and more. And when it comes to our work, for many of us, enough is never enough. We don't know who we are without our work. When we meet somebody, you know, when you meet somebody for the very first time, where does the conversation go? Hi, I'm Rob. Hi, I'm Bill. You know, the first question often follows that one. So what do you do? Yeah. What do you do? To a large degree, we live in a world where the yardsticks that define our personal identity and worth as individuals is wrapped up in our work. And the result is our society is one of overwork, success, and at all costs outperform. Edge of our seats. Despite the fact that we supposedly have more discretionary time than ever, most people I know are kind of like the woman we saw in the drama today. We're so busy, our schedules are so tight, and the pace is so fast that words like rhythm and balance aren't part of our working vocabulary. And something inside us says, life shouldn't be this way. Shouldn't be this work-dominated, this frantic, this busy, this unbalanced. 3,500 years ago, God gave this word that is as relevant today as it ever was. And it's the word, take a break. Limit your work and institutionalize in your life rest. Don't just take a rest when you can. Make it a pattern and a priority in the rhythm of your week. And one of the first things that I hope you see is that number 4 in the Big Ten is a life value prescription from the designer of life himself. And it has everything to do with work and with rest. Because you see, work and human labor is a gift from God. It really is. Work allows us to find purpose and a sense of our usefulness. It allows us to experience the joy of creativity and accomplishment. It adds meaning to our lives. But like many of God's good gifts, it can be abused. And when that happens, the structure and health and joy of our lives is diminished. In number 4 of the Big Ten, God isn't just arbitrarily ordering people to take a day off for every 6 days they work. He's inviting people to participate in the very rhythm in which he created the world. 6 days of work and then one for rest is a pattern built into the very creation of the world. And there's this balance of life, a flow, a rhythm in this creational pattern. And that work-rest pattern is part of the full, rich life that God desires his people to experience and to enjoy the results of. You know, I was struck again this week by how we ignore this divine design at our peril. A few years ago, there was a book written by a guy named Martin Moore-Aid. And the book was called The 24-Hour Society. And in this book, he points out that our most notorious industrial accidents of the last couple of generations, like what you think about the Exxon Valdez spill, or Three Mile Island, or Chernobyl, or the fatal navigational error of Korean Airlines Flight 007, all of these things occurred in the middle of the night. When the USS Vincennes shot down an Iranian A-300 Airbus, killing all 290 people aboard, fatigue-stressed operators in the high-tech combat information center on the carrier misinterpreted the radar data and repeatedly told their captain that the jet was descending as if to attack, when in fact the airliner remained on a normal flight pattern. Or think about the Challenger space shuttle disaster. Those key NASA officials made the ill-fated decision to go ahead with the launch after working 20 hours straight and getting only 2 to 3 hours sleep the night before. And their error in judgment cost the lives of 7 astronauts and nearly killed the U.S. space program. Now, these are high-profile public disasters, all resulting from ignoring God's pattern of work and rest. And tragic as those are, you know what concerns me even more? What concerns me even more are the low-profile, private disasters that happen every day in many of your and my life because number 4 of the Big Ten is often not part of our lives. It's this unrelenting pace of life with the casualty is often a marriage that's slowly growing colder and more distant. Or the casualty is a parenting relationship that incrementally is losing effectiveness and connection. Or a relationship with God in which his voice is more and more distant and his presence is less and less real. Or sort of an emotional and mental connection and health in one's life that just gets degraded steadily because rest and balance and pacing are not intentionally part of our lives. The simple truth is we ignore our need for rest and renewal at the peril of ourselves and others around us, and it happens every single day. And some of you know exactly what I'm talking about right now. Because despite good intentions, for some of you, too often at the end of a very busy day's work, those who need your love the most, those who are closest to you, that you're most committed to, they just get the leftovers from you. It's leftovers. Because you're just too tired and too drained or too preoccupied to love the people to whom you've made the deepest promises. Here's the deal. God knows that the inevitable rhythms of our lives, he knows these. He knows that if we work 7 days a week, week after week, we will begin to lose perspective on the true meaning of life. We'll get to the point where all we care about are results and to-do lists being checked off, and more deals and higher yields, that will be worn out physically and burnt out emotionally and out of touch with spiritual realities, that will be caught in a downward spiral that weakens our marriages and our families and our friendships and our health and even our moral convictions. And that's why God commands, not a suggestion, he commands, like, close the shop 1 in 7 days. Like, shut off the terminal, close the books, stop the presses, because he knows the creational rhythm and human frailty, and he knows, and in his wisdom and love, he says, do not crash and burn. Don't let work become the dominating factor of your life. There is more to life than work, and you need to explore and experience that. So 1 out of 7, take a break. Stop your work. And with the minutes that remain, I want to get really concrete with you. Because I think you all, I mean, we all get the concept. But I want to get concrete with you on a simple way to make number four shape and restore your life. And I want to talk to you really quickly about three ways in which to build the kind of rest God designed you for into your life. And these are to divert daily and worship weekly and alter course annually. Starts with diverting daily. And what I mean by this is the simple habit, the simple practice of once a day, at some point in your day, either early in the morning or in the middle of the day or maybe late at night, whatever, intentionally divert your attentions to talk with God. Psalm 5 verse 3 says this. It says, each morning, I will look to you in heaven and lay my requests before you. This was written by a morning person, by the way. Each morning. And what it becomes is it becomes like this mini reconnecting time every day where you push out the daily pressures and stresses and agendas and just stop and you quiet your mind and your heart before God. And the way I do this, this is just me, the way I do this, I either take a few minutes in our living room or in my office and just sit in a certain chair, look out the window, and I divert. And I know all kinds of things I've got to be doing that day, but I just divert for a little while and turn my attention to my relationship with God. I divert my thoughts for a few minutes, and I say, God, I'm here. Jesus, my Savior, I'm just in your presence. I'm your follower. I'm your child. And I want to do this day with you. And I'll say, and here are some of my requests. Here's what I need this day. And then I'll typically just read like one of the days of the Bible in 1 year app. And I'll just read it. And it reconnects me to God. And it reminds me why I'm doing the things I'm doing in the day. Divert daily. Second sort of practical thing is to worship weekly. This is that one day out of seven to again remember and refocus who God is and to recalibrate with who and what we are to be. Luke chapter 4, verse 16, mentions this about Jesus. On the Sabbath day, Jesus went to the synagogue, as was his custom. This was the practice. This is the custom throughout history, where God's people gather in large groups with other people who share their faith, and on that one day in seven, they refocus on God and recalibrate their own lives. And the benefits are so striking. I've always loved the story about two men who were called into this very tiring job of clearing a field of trees. And the contract called for them to be paid per tree. And the first guy is a guy named Bill, and he wanted the day to be profitable, and so he went at it. And he was just grunting and sweating and swinging his axe relentlessly all day long. And the other guy was a guy named Ed. Ed, on the other hand, seemed to be working about half as fast. And he regularly took little intervals to rest. Staff sat off to the side for a few minutes regularly, while Bill kept chopping away with every muscle and every tendon in his body just screaming. At the end of the day, Bill was wasted and done, but Ed was smiling and telling jokes. Even more amazing, Ed had cut down way more trees. This is very bothersome to Bill. Bill said, hey, listen, I noticed you sitting while I was working without even taking a break. How did you outwork me? And Ed smiled and said, well, every time I sat down, I took a few minutes to sharpen my axe. You know, on Sunday, you not only stop working, but when you worship, when you get out of bed and you get dressed or you dress your kids, and then you get out into the weather, whether it's a nice day or not a nice day, and then you make your way into this place, you know what you're doing? Among other things, you're sharpening your axe. God says, take this one day, one in seven, to sharpen your life. There's this disposition in all of us to forget what's important in life and who gives life meaning and who we're trying to please with our lives. That we live 140 or 150 hours a week that are immersed in environments and settings that often confuse and confound what is most important in life and who or what you should live for and what kind of person you should be. Let me give you another metaphor. You know, many times when I stand right here before you on a Sunday, I sometimes feel like a doctor performing open heart surgery. Because this brief hour is the only time some of you fully open your hearts to the truths of God's word. And for a little while, the defenses get dropped that you've hidden behind during the week. And the defenses are down to allow God to touch and to do something in your heart. And I'm very aware the stakes of this surgery are high. Because it's spiritual life and death. It's hope or hopelessness. It's a marriage that's rebuilding or crumbling. It's wholeness or brokenness. Heaven or hell. Faith or despair. Life or death. And the truth is, we all need to put aside work on a Sunday and gather for surgery. And some of you, when you come, some weeks you come, it's a crucial kind of surgery you get. Surgery, crucial things like sin or death and eternity. And then other times you're here, it's like minor surgery. It's like a little nip and tuck. You just need some challenge. You need some encouragement. You need some comfort. But in one way or another, all of us need this time of rest to refocus our priorities and connect at a heart level with God. Because here's the reality. Most of us will not find our lives adrift, our most important relationships shipwrecked, or our faith lost because of a great calamity or a disaster that strikes our lives. For most people, it happens because their lives get too crowded and hurried. And no solid resolution, no pattern of time to worship weekly was just anchoring them. Now, many of you, this is kind of a recent thing in your life. Many of you, it's something you've just begun to do, is to make this a part of the rhythm of your life. Others of you, it's sort of the first time in years and you're doing this again. But I also know that others of you need a strong encouragement to renew this decision to once again make worship a priority. And let me just say this, even when you don't feel like it, even on those Sunday mornings you don't feel like it, because I know others, because I cannot tell you how many times I have had or talked with somebody who has said to me, I've had this hundreds of times. People will say, I'm so glad I came to church today. I didn't want to come today. And I'm so glad I came. Because here's what happens all the time. People will come with a sense of guilt and shame, and they'll hear from God, I love you. My son, he died for you, and you matter to me. People will come in discouraged and defeated and be ambushed by encouragement and the presence of God. A person will come in with their life unraveling, with their marriage or their kids or their lifestyle unraveling, and they didn't see it, but then the lights came on and they got a wake-up call. And they left as a changed person, remembering who God is, recalibrating who they are called to be. This setting that happens once every 7 days is too important to miss. It really is. And can I add, for those of you who have kids, keep your kids involved in this pattern. Build it into their lives. Understand how important it is for them to be in Adventureland or sitting with you on a Sunday morning, for them to be experiencing and learning in a regular pattern about the presence of God and who they are and how much they matter to Him. This is part of the pattern you pass on to your kids. And then there's one last sort of way to live this out in your life. And that's not only to divert daily and to worship weekly, but to alter course annually. I've always loved this phrase in Psalm 84. It says this, what joy for those whose strength comes from the Lord, who have set their minds on a pilgrimage to Jerusalem. You know, in the Old Testament, the ancient Israelites made an annual trek to Jerusalem for a special feast. And it would be a week or two, and there would be rest, and there'd be worship, and there'd be reconnecting with family, and there'd be feasting, and there'd be just time with friends and family, and there'd be spiritual renewal in all of this. But in all of this, also what people were experiencing was this annual experience where they also experienced again the beauty of God and what it means to play. To play. For many of you, this is a non-point. Some of you, many of you have no trouble playing at every opportunity you can. But I know a lot of us rarely, play rarely happens. It doesn't seem important enough, and we don't plan for it. God created us to be able to enjoy this world that He has made. And one writer says it this way. He says, the Sabbath is the sign of God over the human race, destined for playfulness. Because when God finished creating this world and humankind as His finishing touch, it says that He rested. And that doesn't mean that God was resting because He was tired, like He was worn out, He was fatigued. When it says God rested, it was His enjoyment of the good and perfect and complete creation. It was His enjoying of the paradise He had created. And Sabbath is learning to taste and enjoy the splendor and the mystery of God's life and creation. So take time when you stop to work, and even once a year in a special way, to play, to do what God, you know, it refreshes you to enjoy the beauty of the world and the God who made you. See, life was never meant to be lived constantly at the edge of your seat. And what we desperately need, if we're honest enough to admit it, are regular doses of God's re-energizing power in our lives. And so God says, live your life in the rhythm that I've built right into the design of the world. Make a standing resolution to take a break, to divert daily, to allow time with God, with your Savior Jesus, to worship weekly. Every 7 days, put your work aside. Gather with other Christians to recalibrate your heart and your life, and alter course annually. Be serious about play, about periodic getaways to remember who you are and who God is and what your purpose in this life is. And if you do these things, you'll never wear out the front part of your seat.
I'm going to invite the praise team to come back up and just a couple of reflections on that as well. And that's Pastor Rob mentioned later in the service, just after that, actually, they sing a song and then he came back on the stage. And he mentioned the idea of taking a Sabbath or taking a rest from not just our work, but also our phones or our devices, or I'd pretty much add all electronics to that. Things that are mentally exhausting, but not necessarily draining physically. Taking a break from the endless scrolls and the dopamine hits, you know, you get from watching cat videos. Just get some rest. It's something I would encourage you to do as well. Just set some time aside to put the screens away, put the distractions away, and rest so you can also sharpen your axe. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for the gift of rest. Thank you for the refreshment we get from taking a break and just resting in your grace and in your presence. Help us to find the true rest that only comes from Jesus. And thank you for setting the example for us and reminding us in your word that when you made us, you built that need for rest within us. Father, we also pray that we would not waste that time when we are resting. Move in us through your spirit and nudge us, prompt us, show us ways we can sharpen our axes, so that we'll be ready to work again when you call us to. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We'll stand to sing this next song.
Thank you.
Has this been a restful time for you? I hope and pray it has been. I thought I saw Bill nodding off a bit, so I'm pretty sure it was restful for him. There's usually about four Bills in congregation, so I'm pretty safe to make that joke. Now, as you go out from here, I pray that you would continue to experience the rest that is found in Jesus Christ. Let's all receive God's parting blessing now as we go in peace. This is from 2 Thessalonians 2, verse 16 through 17. Now may our Lord Jesus Christ himself and God our Father, who loved us and gave us eternal comfort and good hope through grace, comfort your hearts and establish them in every good work and word. Amen.